Yes, so we are at this conference in Frankfurt, the Return of the Aesthetics in American Studies. I'm Laura Bieger from the University of Groningen, and we've just heard Rike Jordan here from the University of Frankfurt talk about the reader as curator, and we are going to continue the conversation about this. And the first thing that I would like to talk to you about is how do your thoughts on the reader as curator, how do they weigh in on contemporary, on ongoing, current debates about reading? There's so much interest in reading right now, and I think this has something to do with a kind of sense that reading is in a precarious state, that books, printed matter is in a precarious state. So I would like to talk a little bit about how you know, how your ideas contribute to ongoing debates about reading.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, thank you for having me. Mm-hmm. I think you absolutely pinpoint an important issue here, that we are very afraid that the book basically vanishes from our hand. And the objects that I engage with really counter that development by bringing books back into their material state, or kind of stressing the material that they, well, apparently lost. Mm-hmm. So we have convoluted, open-ended, disorganized, and fragmentary texts suddenly that stand absolutely opposite to Kindles, to MP3 mm-hmm. streams, mm-hmm. or I don't know, like flicks of your mm-hmm. finger on mm-hmm. your iPhone. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. that is really an interesting trend to see. Basically, both things coexist. Yeah. On the one hand, you yeah. have the iPhone, but on the other hand, yeah. you have a book like Building Stories that's so heavy mm-hmm. and so much mm-hmm. a book
yeah.
that you cannot disregard.
No, or not a book at all.
No, not a book. Yeah, and that's
I think it's fascinating because mm-hmm. it seems to me that you are making something explicit yeah. that is a subplot of that debate. Yeah. I think, you know, the vanishing object yeah. and the kind of concern about reading yeah. in our current culture is fueling, you know, this debate. Mm-hmm. So let's talk about some concerns in this debate. Would you say that the curator is a surface reader? Uh-huh. Is the curator, you know, a reader for meaning, a reader for depth? I mean, yeah. what kind of reader yeah. Is the curator?
I would say the curator, so the reader of these big books or these convoluted objects, is most of all in for the experience mm-hmm. of retrieving exactly mm-hmm. what we just discussed, mm-hmm. of retrieving what is lost from the touch, bringing it back basically into mm-hmm. the hand. So the idea of participation, of interaction, of assembly, of co-making mm-hmm. is really mm-hmm. underlined mm-hmm. here. Not, yeah, like the way we feel sometimes on the internet where everything seems to be kind of passive.
Yeah.
And now suddenly there is activity, mm-hmm. promise, mm-hmm. acting, mm-hmm. action. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what the curator underlines. But on the other hand, we also have to acknowledge that the curator, of course, doesn't write. It's not the author. It's mm-hmm. not the maker. It's just the person mm-hmm. who implements.
Yeah, no, I mean, hence also the parallel yeah. to, you know, ongoing debates about reading, because yeah. it, you know, yeah. you really kind of focus on that,
yeah.
On that side, yeah. like others do too.
Yeah.
But it seems to me that this is almost a theory of reading mm. plus. Reading plus type. Yeah. There's this one yeah. Moment in your talk where you mm. said these objects are not merely published.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah.
It's merely they yeah. also, they are also objects that want to be touched. When we yeah. usually think about reading or talk about reading, we don't
yeah.
think about the dimension of touch, or maybe, you know, the part where we just want to know that a book is there on our shelves. So how does that mm-hmm. factor into the reading experience? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Crafting and interaction, you mean?
Mm-hmm.
Well, it is, like I said, it's more the activity. I think that's mm-hmm. really what factors in here.
Mm-hmm.
From away from passivity, away from, yeah, away from mere consumption to a promise of producing.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that is really what is underlined. If that's really the case, I ask in that project, mm-hmm. I ask in that
mm-hmm.
talk,
mm-hmm.
but that is basically the on the surface, that is the promise that these objects kind
yeah.
of give the reader,
yeah.
give the,
yeah.
the person who buys
yeah.
them.
In terms of mm-hmm. theoretical tools mm-hmm. at hand,
mm-hmm.
You know, and in your talks, you were talking about the position of the reader, or the
yeah.
role as a reader, you know, you're kind of rethinking the role as a reader
yeah.
in terms of curator. For me, that brings to mind reception aesthetics. And so, you know, I would like to to hear from you how useful you find the theory of perception aesthetics for the task of thinking through these problems.
I mean, basically that's just, I mean, shop talk from the dissertation, if you could say so. That's actually what I really started out on thinking about. What happens between the book and, or the aesthetic object, the fictional object, and what happens between that and the reader. So what is kind of their interaction or their relationship? And of course, Wolfgang Isa or Winfried Fluck also talk about that when they develop their ideas of perception aesthetics. But I thought more along the lines, okay, this is on a narrative level of engaging with the text, but here we really, and I have to stress this again, it is really on the material level of interaction, of making sense or working out the story, not only on the narrative level, but really working through and working also with your hands. So it becomes cognitive workout, kind of, so I think that's Frankelita who says that that kind of aesthetic object would offer cognitive workout. That it is material, narrative, but also kind of like a, promises also, kind of a way of feeling smart about yourself because you also know how to engage with this.
So, I mean, what kind of reader position is this curator guy? You know, I mean, on the one hand, he... you know, or she, you know, is in the know, she, you know, she's working, she is, you know, she is empowered, but you also talk about how that position is maybe a disempowered position because you are just kind of replicating the ideals of a an author, of a producer here. I want to push this point a little bit further, and I think that is, for me, really the neuralgic point of this as a contribution to reading. Because it seems to me that the curator as a reader is politically radically disempowered. You know, the curator is a worker, he's kind of caught, is caught in a, you know, in a world of commodities and in a work of labor. But is there a possibility for any kind of transgressive or any kind of real political action for this figure?
Well, that's an excellent question, and that's also a question I struggle with deeply, to ask myself, okay, if that's not merely an aestheticized position of a reader who can feel good about herself or himself, who kind of is in the know, who kind of knows how to navigate the niches, who's kind of fluent in pop culture and who knows kind of how to position herself to also be recognized to others. And but also to say being recognized for others is also something political, I would say. So we want to also be recognized to belong and to kind of form community and communal action.
But that's identity politics.
Yeah, true. And that is also kind of denied in these objects because how is that really a communal way of building a story or making a song? So I think that is, you're absolutely right, that that is basically a reader or a subject position that is very well encouraged and invited to think through herself through a commodity. And to
I had a sense that both sides, I mean, the objects are so self-involved, you know, but that also kind of creates a reading position that is so radically self-involved. You know, so there is an interesting kind of congruence in terms of, you know, text-reader relation here. That's, I think, deeply disturbing if you, if you think about, you know, possible political action that can come out of this.
I mean, it can be, I mean, if you really wanted to push it to the really extreme, you could say this is a really alienating work, but in the sense of alienating yourself from others, because you do not go out, I mean, and kind of co-mingle or mingle with your friends or do something, sit in a bar, but you're basically at home and trying to figure this out by yourself. And that is also a lonely activity. I mean,
and then you get to post the results on Instagram.
And then you can post them on Instagram and hope you get 2 likes.
Oh, well, sad world.